In this episode, we're going to be talking about bottom contours. If you've never heard the phrase bottom contours, then it's what we call the particular shaping of the underside of the surfboard, the surface that the water flow will obligingly follow thanks to something known as the Coanda effect, in which a fluid flow attaches itself to a surface and remains attached even when the surface curves away from the initial flow direction. What this means is that we can control the water flow direction underneath the board, and with it we can encourage either more speed or more maneuverability depending on what we are attempting to achieve from the design of the board. We can use a combination of concave, convex, and flat surfaces to create an almost infinite number of variations depending on what the board is designed for. So let's take a look at some of the most common components. We'll start with a concave bottom. A concave, or single concave as it's sometimes referred to, creates a channel that runs along the length of the board between the nose and the tail, guiding the water into a clean and direct flow. If you remember some of the physics that are featured in previous episodes, you'll know that the more water we have travelling towards the tail of the board, or the faster that flow of water, the greater potential for lift and thrust there is. Surfers have been employing this technique since the 40s, with Bob Simmons credited with its introduction, along with many of the fundamental hydrodynamic principles of surfboard design. A concave design typically suits surfboards that have speed in mind, for example small wave boards that need to maximise the little energy available to them, and powerful or barreling waves where down the line speed and grip are essential, and where turning manoeuvres are perhaps not the priority. Once up to speed, boards with concave bottoms have a tendency to continue in that direction, a feature known as tracking, which to some is a blessing as it means it will hold its line well, though if the rider wants to change direction, one has to overcome that tracking by transferring more weight into the back foot to turn the board. Although it's not specifically known why, a concave also assists in producing grip from the rail when in trim mode, and from it comes down the line speed. It is thought to be from a more favourable angle of attack where the water flow coming up the wave face is redirected by the rail. And this combined with the lift generated over the length of the board, it's why a concave is generally accepted as the fastest bottom contour. The convex bottom was the first innovation in bottom contour design, moving away from flat bottoms in an effort to make the heavier solid wood surfboards more manoeuvrable. A convex is almost entirely the opposite of a concave channel, and resembles somewhat of a belly underneath the board across its width. This encourages the board through a rail-to-rail rolling motion during a turn. Convex bottoms, though more manoeuvrable, create more form drag as a result of a greater frontal area, and so are typically slower than an otherwise identical concave board. A convex bottom can reduce the hold and tracking nature of the board down the line, and so it is at risk of slipping out of trim and dropping down the wave face if the necessary rail pressure is not maintained. A flat bottom isn't so much a contour, but more so the absence of a contour, and was once the standard before much thought had gone into the underside design of the surfboard. We can safely say that a flat contour lands somewhere between the concave and convex, as some of the water will move out towards the rails and some will travel down the length of the board and out the tail, and so no specific benefit or loss will occur, assuming we have no expectations for the design. In 1967, famed shaper Bob McTavish created the plastic machine model, a 9-foot board with a deep V-shaped keel through the back of the board and wide tail. This particular board became one of the first examples of the coming shortboard revolution, with designs eventually going from 10-foot down to 7-foot or less over the course of just a few years. It was during McTavish's quest for a more radically manoeuvring board that he employed the deep V bottom contour. Similar to the convex bottom, a V will direct water out to the rails, and so although compromising the lift for down the line speed, it does allow for a lightning fast response when transitioning rail to rail by the rider. When a surfer is riding in trim, a V-bottom provides only half the board width as a planing area, and so they typically require a higher speed to stay on the plane. In big wave surfboards where speed is in abundance, a more subtle V can be of an advantage, as it helps the rider maintain control at high speeds by producing less overall lift. In lesser powered waves, however, a V-bottom can be described as feeling bogged or slow due to the low planing area reducing lift and thus creating drag. A double concave is where there are two side-by-side channels that can run the length of the surfboard. They follow the same principle as a single concave, whereby directing water from nose to tail to increase lift and thrust. The difference from a single concave is that a double concave doesn't track with the same security and speed that a single concave might, due to the V running between the two concaves, which will increase drag overall, but does allow for a better rail-to-rail response during a turn. Channels produce a similar and often stronger effect than a concave with their more angular design. They're normally found in the tail of the board around the fins and aid in speed generation by directing water out of the rear of the surfboard and by resisting a slipping and sideways movement in the same way a center fin helps to reduce a loss of forward motion. Now, although I've described each variation independently, they are generally implemented in harmony with each other at differing points along the surfboard. If we break down the function and goal of each part of a specific board, we can allocate a complementary contour to suit. For example, let's look at a standard performance shortboard, starting at the front half. When paddling or accelerating when stood up, much of our weight is leaning on the front half of the board. Therefore, a single concave under the chest or front foot position is going to maximize the speed and load drag required to catch the wave or accelerate the board when necessary. Moving on to just behind the front foot is a transitional point, where we might want to have both options of generating speed and some maneuverability, say to move up and down the wave face. So a double concave could suit this point, whereby we want lots of speed as we apply pressure to the front foot as our gas pedal, but not so much tracking and rigidity that it is difficult for small adjustments. As we now move closer to the back foot, where when in use it's to create dramatic direction changes, then a convex, or more likely a V-bottom, will be used for a quick rail-to-rail response. Like many features in our surfboards, everything has a specific purpose, and recognizing those can allow us to choose the right board for the right conditions. Try having a look at the bottom of your board and see if you can deduce what the shaper was thinking. Thanks for watching, and subscribe below.